Back everyone to this session. Right. Almost everyone has joined the session now. The afternoon, next 1.5 hours, we are actually going to start have a sharing of what is the process of developing e-content. So before we start the session, there is a question from the previous session regarding using the YouTube video. Can we just have your videos on, please? Actually, we are connected virtually. We can't see each other. So at least sometimes we can see our faces, which gives little bit motivation to start and go forward. Yeah. Thanks. This time many more are on the video, so I can take really the photographs. Last time there was many people were not on video. Thank you so much. I'll just take the photos of everyone. Northeast team, many are having an issue with internet, I guess, so they are not able to open, but still. Good to see all your faces. There are still many more who couldn't open your video. Thanks a lot. So at least till we share some screen, we can see each other through video, that in case you don't have an internet issue, so that it motivates us to at least to continue our session. So I hope the first session was informative for you with regarding to e-content development. Though we have understood about what is OER and what are the various licenses that we can use it, now we are going to discuss about the process of developing the e-content. So one question which is there in the chat box is related to the YouTube. They have given the detailed link also that the license is not very clear. Since we have partnership with Google and we have already clarified this, I would really like to clarify this particular point, because many states' content has YouTube video embedded into it. So as per YouTube license, we are not allowed to download any video from YouTube because it is a platform license. So morning we were discussing about two things, like one is the license for the content, and one is the license from the platform. So though the content which is uploaded by, like for example, NCERT has uploaded a lot of content in YouTube. We have our own YouTube channel. We have uploaded our content. We have released everything under CC by SA. But by putting into YouTube, we are not permitting anybody to download that content and use it further. That is why we make the content available in multiple platforms also. But for example, in Diksha platform, we have uploaded our content under Creative Commons, because each and every one, when you upload, you may have a difference. I may upload it as CC by SA. Somebody may upload it as CC by NC by SA. But still, the platform has a license CC by 4.0, which allows anybody to download all the content from the portal and reuse it, share it, modify it. That is what the platform of Diksha has. So that is where we always try to tell to the state, whenever we create e-content, do not restrict ourselves putting only the content in our YouTube channel, but make it available in any platform which people can download. The other thing which we do is we keep all this content in the state websites. We have our state portal, state websites, we keep our content. Sometimes we release it in our own blogs everywhere, but we don't declare any license. We simply keep uploading it. As per the policy, if you do not write that this content is released under Creative Commons, if there is no license mark, that is considered to be copyrighted material. So that doesn't mean if you are searching for a content, there is no license written. There is no specification of whether it is Creative Commons, which license it is. In that case, that material is assumed or considered to be a copyrighted material. We are not supposed to use such material as well. So if you find any such resource, if you are able to find a source from where that content has come, then you have to write and take permission to use that content. And you should have that license, that letter with you. There was one teacher who was from Karnataka, who's a primary school teacher, who belongs to a village who has used the picture. This was a 10 years back story, which I'm telling you. He has created his workbook for his schools, for his own students. So he started using that workbook and he used the Disney image, Donald Disney image as a cover page because it is for primary level. So he started using it. But when after some time, when that particular people found, many friends found that it is useful, they all started asking him to share that resource and they also started using it. So when he started putting it on online, after 6-7 months, he got a letter from Disney's office stating that you have used the official logo of Disney in your book and published, you have to legally face the consequence. So we may not know, right? Earlier, we were all printing and using it within ourselves. We don't have that problem. But right now, since all the content are going online, we do not know how it will be used, where it will be going. So it is very important that we need to be very careful about OER resources. Even in one of our NCERT websites, we have used in the long term before when NCERT, they have created one video where one of the resource person has taken a small video clip from YouTube and he has given to the producer just to integrate it. So that the producer has just done as for the resource person who has come for the workshop. But we have to get a complaint from the source who has prepared that video that it is not copyright free. You are not supposed to use it. So it's very important that YouTube never take any video from YouTube. If you find some good video from YouTube, then you have to write to the author of that resource. That is where whenever you upload, maybe you are creating a new content and you have uploaded in your YouTube. It is mandatory to write in your description that this material is released under CC by SA or whatever license, but you also need to give for using this license or for getting this license, you have to give your contact details. Then only it is useful really for others. Otherwise, you are creating it free with all good sense, but you are putting in a platform which doesn't give freedom for others to use it. So this is one main point, let us keep in mind, because now running a YouTube channel has become very, very popular by every education person, but it is very important to also tell that our resource becomes really fully, freely for others, okay? I think we are through with this question. Let's keep moving to the next session. And I guess you would have seen the license of Diksha. There are some questions which is coming up. I would like to, even though it is related to OER, I will be taking up that questions after some time so that we'll start the session. Because it's this OER and license is a session which you get a lot and lot of questions. We will continue our discussion, but let us start the next session with us. So thanks for keeping your videos open. Because it gave a little bit of encouragement that people are really watching and listening. Because sometimes we feel in virtual, everyone keeps the video off, then go to sleep, right? But we know that you're not sleeping. You will be having some other office works parallelly, which is put forward to you. But I request all of you to be with us because we are doing with all our effort to bring this real capacity building in the state, which this SRG team is going to implement again training in the state. So we are requesting you to be part of it. Please clarify all your queries. If you have some observations, share it with us so that it will be a meaningful learning. So let me start sharing my screen with you all to start the session. Okay. This is also related. I think my screen is visible. Can any one of you open your mic and just Okay, I have got a confirmation. So this is the image which I have already shared it in the in your group as well. And you can also see this image is very, very important, because many times what we do is we try to download a content which is CC by SA. For example, you can see here, this is a material which is downloaded as CC by SA. Can you remove me from host, because I'm getting disturbance? So co-host. Okay. Yeah. Sorry, because it's a little bit of disturbance along with mine. So you can see this chart. If I have a material which is somebody has released it as CC by SA, this material can be used by me, and what all the licenses it can be declared. So you can see I can use this material, but I cannot use it and again declare it under CC by NC. Okay. So this is how this chart helps you to understand what license I get, what license I can release. So this is very important chart. Please keep this as a reference with you for further preparations of your materials. If you have further queries on this chart, we will take it as a separate discussion. Okay. So my presentation is going to be on process of developing e-content. So we are all into development of e-content at one or the other level. Some of you would be preparing your content at your individual level. Some of you may be preparing your content at the state level, right? But if you can see the process we follow, as an individual, you will follow different processes. As a state, sometime we follow different processes, right? So we are going to just understand now, as you're all going to be a state resource group, you're going to tell to others how this development process has to be followed. So we will be focusing more on at the state level or at a district level, as an organizational level, how we have to follow developing e-content. But we'll also be here and there, I'll be giving a notation about what exactly will be followed when you are doing individually as well. Okay. So these are some of the variety of e-content we keep preparing ourselves. And you also know that these are the resources which These are some of the resources which we keep creating, maybe for Diksha, maybe for your classroom, or maybe for your state portal and all. But while preparing this content, what are we really going to create? Or what are we really going to create? Really, I explain everything. I want to have a small discussion between you to share your own way you are following it. So what we are going to do is we are going to break you into smaller groups, and we are going to give you just 5 minutes time. I'll just stop sharing this. So what we are going to do is we are going to do break you into small breakout rooms. In our face-to-face board, we will make small groups and make them into do a group discussion. Same thing we are going to do now virtually. If you are not used to that, you have not faced it, just to give you a notation, the moment we say that you will go to breakout room, you will go into a smaller room. Okay. Right now we have around 225 participants. Maybe you will have only 30 participants in your group. Right. After you go to the room, it will automatically take you to the group. If you are not going also, we will be able to see here. We will be sending you into different rooms. And in the room, now 30 people will come together, and you are expected only 5 minutes we are going to give. And in that, we don't know which state participant will be in which group. It's a randomized group. So 5 minutes you will take to at least 2-3 people in the group to share. Till 5 minutes, you can keep sharing. One person should not talk for 5 minutes. Each person cannot talk more than 30 seconds. Okay. So altogether 10 people can share. Maybe if once 3 people are from same state, only one person can share from one state. So it is your own management now. We are not going to come inside the room. One of you will take the lead in the group. You will discuss yourself and discuss what is the different process being followed in the different state. Are we ready? If you're ready, can you give me a thumbs up? I don't see any thumbs up. Not hand raised, thumbs up. So where do we get the thumbs up? Below your participants list, you will see something called more, where you will see thumbs up. So we will, as a part of this training, we will also learn all the small features of program, of all these tools as well. So those who are not knowing, slowly you can learn. Don't bother about it. Slowly you can keep learning. So I'll just take a minute to break you into smaller rooms. I'm sorry, there is a technical issue which is not allowing them to send you into the rooms. They are just sorting out. But this discussion, we will just take it at the end of the session also. There's no issue out of it. But we will be having some discussion. You can keep preparing the points also. So let's continue with our presentation now. I think my screen is visible for you. Yeah. So let us start discussing about the process actually we need to follow. Okay. So this is the process which is accepted format. There is several instructional designing models that can be followed. The very simple one that can be used by us is this particular model, which we call it as ADDIE model of instructional design. So what does ADDIE model stands for? Each word has a meaning for it and it has certain steps involved in it. So A stands for analysis, D stands for design, the second D in ADDIE stands for develop, I stands for implement, and E stands for evaluate. So let us try to understand each step, what is that all about. So when we talk about analysis, it covers the need analysis, context analysis, learner, and content. We are going to just do a small activity now. You are able to see on the screen a QR code as well as a link. right? So I'll just put this link in the screen as well, in the text box also, so that it is easy for you to do the activity. Please, all of you, take your mobile or a tab in your desktop or open a browser so that it helps you to use this link. I've given the link in the chat box. So you can use the link or you can scan this QR code. You will be able to get a question like this with three boxes. Are you all able to access it? Click on the link. And you will get a question like this, along with three boxes. There is a spelling mistake here. I'm sorry for that. So you will be getting three boxes. In that three boxes, you need to write three parameters which you will be analyzing while developing the e-content. So what are the three things which you will really analyze while developing e-content? Type your answer and submit it. I've started getting the answers on the screen. Let me also quickly check if there is anybody having an issue. Yeah. Right. So please click on the link. You will be able to get a question with three boxes. Write your answers on that. 10 persons have already given your answers. We can see the answers coming up on the screen. So we have around 57 participants have given your answer. We'll take up to 100 participants' response and then start discussing, but others can keep giving your response till you complete it. We have got response from 90 persons till now. So we can see here there are a lot of answers coming in. Thanks for all your responses. But there is something which has come as a central point is the content. Maybe some of you would have just answered with without thinking also, but there is a lot of answers which have become very relevant to us. So you can see here, most of us have expressed that content is one of the parameters which we need to really see. And this is one of the tool which has really brought out the importance of content also. For example, I'm just conducting this activity and morning Bera sir conducted another activity, right? So morning sir used a tool called Kahoot. And now I'm using a tool called Mentimeter. And he was having a multiple choice question, but I'm using a word cloud. Why we have used two different tools and two different formats? It is because the content is different. For when he conducted the quiz, he wanted to know which is the right answer. So he used that particular format. And then he started creating the content in the tool which will support it. So he used the Kahoot tool. Since he wanted to also motivate people like who is participating with the names, he used that tool. But now, because I want only your opinions, not the right and correct, wrong or correct answer. So I've just used a format called this word cloud, because I don't need like who has answered what, and because I don't know, like I'm not going to give first, second, third out of it. But particularly right now, the content I'm looking out is opinions of people. What do they think? So that is what has decided for me to create a e-content of a word cloud, which has been used by a particular tool. So as most of you has told, the very, very first important thing that we need to really keep as a parameter for analysis is the content. So I would like to just tell you a few examples how content becomes very important when you are developing the e-content. So some of the states were presenting the content, which they have developed in the last workshop. So one of the states, just to show us a material, which is basically on a science experiment. So they have to just show that two chemicals react like this, and this is the precipitate which will be formed at the bottom of the test tube. So they have tried creating the video of it in an actual lab. So when they actually created that content, they have tried recording the whole video. They have done a demonstration video, and it has been completely completed, and it is supposed to be shared with all the state team. But when you watch that video, we can understand that In the particular precipitate which you have to show, when the video has zoomed to the minute part of the test tube also, the precipitate was not at all very much clear, because it's a very light trace and it is again a white precipitate which is not very much visible even when they have recorded using a camera. Okay. Because it's a lab experiment, they have decided to record a demonstration video. But the content, what you wanted to show, is actually the precipitate formation, which is not able to be captured. So it is very, very important that that particular part becomes the main part. So they have to use at least a animated or a simulated content or an animated content at that part of the video itself to show that this is what the content we wanted to really contribute in that particular part. So it's very important that content becomes very important. The other case which I could share the importance of content is when we are using, for example, digestive system. So digestive system cannot be shown or recorded as it is. So, but content of the digestive system is to show the process, not just the parts. If just it is the parts, you can just decide to select the content as we are going to create an image. So what is that you wanted to tell? Whether parts of digestive system, then image is enough. But if you want to talk about the process of digestive system, image is not sufficient. You need a video to show that. But when you go for video, can you prepare a video by recording the actual digestive system? It is not possible. So what is the next option? You have to simulate the environment and create it. Can you create a simulation of a digestive system? It needs a lot of other aspects into it. So the content is the first thing that helps you to derive what type of content you are going to create, what form of the content you are going to create. So this is the first attribute which we need to analyze to find out whether it needs, first of all, a e-content. We were also seeing one of the status created to talk about the capitals. There is a content in social science, the capital of each state. So they have created a video recording the capital of each, where somebody is speaking and there is a PowerPoint which shows like this is this capital. Do we really need a video to be recorded to show that? Do we need, first of all, a e-content for that to be shown? So we have to also ask the first question, whether I need an e-content for this particular content. If yes, then the second question is, based on the content type, what is the type of e-content I will develop? To decide that, we also should know what is the content, whether it is a fact, whether it is a procedure, whether it is a theory, whether it is a theorem, whether it is just a statement. So only if we analyze that, we will be able to decide the appropriate e-content to be developed. The second parameter which has to be analyzed is the context. Many of you have given that context also in here. The context, when we take it, context has two, three aspects included in this. One is the infrastructure. Many states keep creating a lot of content, but when it goes to the field, we don't have system. In the last session, somebody has written in the chat box, yes, everything is good, but until infrastructure is available, nothing cannot be used. We are very happy to develop AR, VR, virtual reality, all type of content. But are we also looking at the context? If I create and give this to the school, what is that going to be there ready for using it? It doesn't mean that because I don't have, I will not create. But when we create and send it, it has to go as a package. Now there is an AR content created for using this. There is a need for having a mobile in the classroom, or there is a need for a system in the classroom. So we have to give that intimation also along with the content itself. Otherwise, the people in the field will not be really beneficial. So only when we discuss, we prepare the content, keeping the context in mind, it will help us. For example, this is one of the workshop I attended in Tamil Nadu when they were creating the content. It was like they were preparing e-content and they were having Tamil and English content. They were actually translating the content to Tamil, which is in English. So in that English content, it was taken like I ate ice cream. So that was the English sentence. Sorry, I eat ice cream. That was a sentence in English which was there. So they were trying to translate the content. So two people from two different regions of Tamil Nadu were part of the workshop. So one person was translating it as Naan ice cream sapite. But another person was writing in Tamil as Naan ice cream kudikire. Like if I say that these two words, one person translated in Tamil, which means I ate ice cream. But another person wrote it as I drank ice cream. Why? Because that particular part of Tamil Nadu only says I drink ice cream. It's not I eat ice cream. So when they translated in Tamil, English, they were using same sentence, I eat ice cream in the textbook. But the moment they went for translation, the regional area comes into the picture. This is common with all the states. We all have context in our place. And in context to context, the words and the terminologies also matters a lot. Even the type of e-content we are creating has to take care of the context in mind. If you are creating some AR content for the people who are not even exposed to a video, then this will become just a play item for the students. So we need to understand whether we are creating, for whom we are creating. And for when you say who, first is this to learner also comes in. Somebody has written already here. Learner comes under the context itself. When I say context, it talks about whom and what, like the whole context where it comes. So it contains the learner. It also talks, covers the infrastructure. It also covers the human resource. These three aspects are to be discussed when you think about the word context. What infrastructure availability is there to use this context? What kind of learner are there before? That is where our inclusive classroom and children with special needs are to be thought about. So when we are creating the content for students, when we are thinking about the learner, it is not just about like whether their age group is fine. There are a lot of content which has come. Whether the age appropriateness is there, whether they have the previous knowledge, these are all related to learner. But it also, the other point which now we have to take care is about the children with special needs. What is the need of the learner? And the third one which comes under the context is our infrastructure. So when we talk about the infrastructure, we also need to think about what is available in our classrooms, what kind of resources are available, what type of infra, like what type of gadgets is available. One of the class was, one of the teacher was excited very much when the state shared with them some content, which is on a simulated content. The particular school teacher was very excited because freely they got a simulated content, which is very useful for students. So he borrowed a laptop from his friend, and he got a projector from the block resource center. He started getting everything in place, but unfortunately the classroom didn't have didn't have the plug point to put the projector on. So this is how we are. Breakout room, you have on?
No.
It has come. So it is sometimes like that we create content and give it in one format, which cannot be used in multiple situations. So it is not that we should not create content because our situation is like that, but we have to give the content in various formats. For example, now we have Diksha as a portal. We have created a lot of content. We have put every content in Diksha. But whether every classroom has internet facility to use the content in Diksha, because right now all the content is not available offline to use it in Diksha. So in such cases, are we also trying to deliver the content in different formats? So this decision can come only when you first analyzing time itself, if you think about what is my context. So that is also very important to discuss about. So during the analysis phase, these are some of the questions we need to think about. Does the content demand e-content? If it is demanding, what type of content we need to create as per the content? Whether the use of e-content is suitable for the learners whom we are targeting. So it can be the features of demographic, cognitive, physiological, socio-cultural aspects of the learner has to be taught about. And the next point, as we thought about, is about the infrastructure as well as the resource persons. Sometimes we create the content which is not suitable to be used by our teachers. So it is very, very important to even think about what aspects, what skill set our teachers have. In case if we create this content, what is the follow-up activity it has to be done so that this content will be utilized properly. So I'll just stop here and take any questions which is related to the analysis part. If anyone has any questions, so I'll just check it out as for my understanding. There is no question as such. Okay. Do anybody has a question, would like to just raise your hand? One question which I could take it up at this point. Or can I put the question in the other way? breakout room is ready. Yeah. Right now, for discussing the further question, we are going to put you in the breakout rooms. If something technically is getting difficult, we will help you out. So, yeah. You will be sent into the breakout room. You need to share what process you are following in the state. Is there anyone who has not joined the breakout room yet? I could see many people there.
So many people, right? Room 1, 19, 18, 20.
But still some people are there who have not joined. Huh? Okay. Any one room. Randomly assigned.
No, first time is randomly. Second time is not randomly.
No, I am telling you allowed to any room. Okay. All these people. You have to assign me to room number 2.
Number 2, two.
What you did? Close?
No, no. मैं आपको कॉल करूँ, एक मीटिंग में था मैम, कॉल करता हूँ।
We have sent everyone into smaller rooms, so others are in the smaller rooms. So those who have joined now, so we will be sending you again into smaller rooms. So kindly wait.
So what are we going to do in our group? Hi everyone, what are we going to do in our group?
You are now back to the main group. Yeah, all are coming back to the group.
Sir, I think it's better we introduce ourselves and that they will give some topic for discussion.
Hello?
Everyone has started your discussion just now, but you are back to the main.
It's echoing.
All the participants are back to the main room. Because after we send you, only now you have started the discussion itself. You have started and we have brought you back to the main room. So I think none of you have been able to start the discussion and many of you were not able to join because of your network connectivity. So this is only a first technical experience for many of you to go to the breakout room and come back. So we will be giving some questions again to break you into smaller groups, and then we will take up this discussion. Are you all back to the presentation mode? Some groups have already done the discussion. Very few couldn't just start by the time we finished your discussion, because it's 5 minutes is very, very short in the room to start your discussion itself. So we'll be giving very useful discussion you had, very good. Sabarinagan sir has written that they had a useful discussion. Room 3 has done their discussion. Yes, it's very absolutely short. So this is just to introduce you to have such group discussions, but we will be having like these group discussions in the further sessions for a little longer time to do some group activities. I just thought of introducing it to you in this session so that it doesn't disturb the group work. Thank you so much. And Shobha Madam has written that in most of the states, they are following the same process, right? Yeah. So let us come back to our presentation to understand like what really is the process to be followed. And let us cross-verify ourselves whether we are in the right process. Are we missing something? Is something you will be reflecting yourself? Because at the end of the day, you need to write in the forum, what is the issues or what are the gaps which is there in the process that needs to be followed, but what is being followed by us? So please, when we are going forward, keep checking yourself. Or if you have something else which you are following it as a success, but which is not going to be discussed by me, then you can also share that in today's forum, right? So the second step, after you analyze all the content, the second step is the design phase. This is a place, most of the time, all of us do the analysis because all of us are teachers and all of us have come back. All of us are into the teaching process and we know very well that there should be an analysis, because even while writing lesson plan, we have done all this analysis, right? This is not new. It is known to everyone. Maybe I'm putting into a different heading, but we all know that whenever you are going to prepare a lesson also, you need to think about all these things. But while developing e-content, the major area where there is a gap is in the design phase. When we are doing design phase, there are three major things that has to be taken care of. One is instructional strategy design. The second is visual design. And the third is technical design. So when you see this three designs levels, when you see this, most of us are aware that this instructional strategy design is something which we all know, because we are teachers, we are dealing with this, we know like what to be given in the content, whether I have to explain, whether I have to show them, whether I have to make people to watch here or remind something or highlight something. These all comes under instructional strategy design, which we are most of the time we are aware. But the major gap is this two place. The visual design and the technical design is something which is always a gap when we discuss with the state when they develop the e-content. So though we are aware of this, let me just take you through a quick points on this. What we really do. So in learning instructional strategy design, this is something which we really do as a plan. One is like, what is the objective of this particular e-content? For what purpose I'm preparing? Whether it is aligned with the content? These are some of the things we make a note of it. We list out the objectives. We say like, okay, this is the content which is given in the syllabus. This is the content for which I'm going to create the content. So there we also align ourselves with the objectives. Or right now, it's about the learning outcomes. Whenever you create any content, it should align with the learning outcome or a learning objective, which will help us to frame the content further. The second aspect is the content structure itself. we always think about like what the content has to be placed there, whether we will keep explaining the content as it is. No, we first try to chunk the content. We like, for example, if you're going to teach about the content for triangle, maybe finding area of a triangle in class 6, but what we do is, first of all, we chunk it. There is some previous knowledge which they know about triangle, so it's like previous knowledge on triangle as a shape which they would have learned till class 5. The second chunking we will do is like, we will say that, okay, after previous knowledge, we need to recall the concept of triangle in terms of its definition. So that's like a concept of triangle. Then we also have a chunk called types of triangle. After that, we will go into area of triangle, particular type wise. So we do this chunking in a very nice manner. But whenever this chunking is not done, then the content which is prepared also will not be an effective resource for anybody. We do see while evaluating that the chunking is not done properly, but this is one of the area which we need to do. How do we really chunk it? How many topics we can chunk it together into one content? Many times we create one content for the whole chapter. Or sometimes we create one resource for only one topic in that. So it depends on how we are breaking the content and how we are going to give to the people. There is no hard and fast rule that you have to break it like this. For example, when this online courses for students have started in Swayam portal, there was a rule like you have to create the course with 40 modules. So if you take class 11 course and you wanted to only give 40 modules, what will happen? And in that each module, you should have only 30 minutes video, the 5,000 reading words reading material, then a 10 question quiz. So when there is a rule that you have to do 40 modules, what will automatically happen? The content the person who's preparing the content will just equally distribute the content into 40 chunks. They'll not put really effort to say that this is very important content. This needs more more time to prepare the content. This is having little less. There won't be such kind of decision making. So as a state resource team, we also should understand many states do this, that putting a rule that you have to break the lesson into two content or create 100 content out of this chapter. Such restrictions will surely affect the content developer while they are chunking the content. Such kind of things should not be made as a rule while developing e-content. Because when we started developing content, we came to know for each video, prepare 10 presentation, 10 video, 10 this. So you cannot say that 10 has to be created because it has to be aligned with the content. Sometimes it is simple to complex. So I may use a very simple type of a resource, but something is very concrete to abstract. So I need to put a lot of effort. So it's very important that based on the content, the structure will be made, and based on the structure, the content will type will be decided. So as a state team, when we develop content, we should not lay restrictions that will stop them by doing this exercise of analyzing the content and planning and designing the content structure. Also, while we are doing a content structure, as an overall, we should have a content map. This is something we really feel is something which is missing in most of the state. Individually, resources will be distributed for development. One person develops on types of triangle, another person develops on area of triangle. But holistically, when you take this chapter, we need to have a content map to say that in this particular chapter, these are the different types of content which is available. These two major topics are chunked together, and this particular topic will be created as a particular resource. This kind of a content map need to be created at holistically at the state level, and then the content development has to be distributed. So this is in the design phase itself, we need to create. Only when you create this, we will be able to evaluate how many resource persons are required, how much timeline is required. Many times since we don't do this, this all gets affected. The third thing which we need to think about is also the learning strategies. Why are you really preparing this content, and what all you will include in your content? So you can see here whether the way you are planning to prepare the content should be relevant to learning outcomes. So when you're designing the content, when you're telling that I'm going to make a interactive using H5P, just because H5P is available and H5P is possible to be uploaded in Diksha, we should not create. Whether it is really useful to check relevant to the learning outcome if I create this content using H5P. That is very, very important to question. And also the e-content, the type we are creating, whether it is will be really motivating and interesting, whether it has scope for participation. Many of our e-content are one way, because the platform is also sometimes one way. We keep just putting the content in one side and it goes to the other side. But where does this scope of participation comes? Participation doesn't mean that you and me, maybe like not a participation, it's more of an engagement. It doesn't mean that you and me are online and then we are discussing, but it also means whether there is a participation of the child with that content, whether I'm able to get into that content. So when we are going to design the content, these are some of the factors we need to keep in mind while we are preparing the content. Most of the videos we create, like for example, you are recording the demonstration video itself. It is more of a teacher showing the showing and saying that this is how you have to do step by step. But is there a question for a child to think? Do we teach class like that, like only keep on speaking from one side? Then there won't be interest of participants to ask to get engaged with that. So there is a need that we always need to have questions or participation to be enabled in the e-content. Not a physical participation, it may be enabled by adding a question into it or a thought-provoking question or thought-provoking activity into it, and sometimes leaving it without answering it completely. So these are some of the learning strategies that can be used while designing your content so that the content will facilitate metacognition as well as it will bring the engagement. The fourth thing which we also need to think about in design itself is most of the time evaluation, we keep it as last part. Because it's evaluation, we don't think about evaluation at the starting. But when we are going to prepare itself, before even preparing, we need to think, okay, if I create this content, how will I evaluate this? While developing, where all I'll get constructive feedback? So we need to prepare that mechanism also. For example, you are creating a video which is getting recorded in the studio of your state. So then you have a process that when you are going to write your storyboard, there is a need that there should be a team who will evaluate your storyboard. After your storyboard is evaluated, you go for the production. You have recorded the video. Then you are doing the editing work. But after editing work, there should be again a team who has to record, review this video to check technically, pedagogically, whether the video has come out very well. And we also need to think about the last part. Okay, after everything is over, when it goes out, what is the mechanism which will be there for checking this? What is the two, three things which we have to keep in mind is how frequently we are going to evaluate, is there a pace of time, like at every step we will evaluate, or just every 1 hour we will evaluate, or every 1 week we will evaluate, or at the end of the development we will evaluate. This evaluation strategy also to be designed at the initial state itself. As per the discussions with the states from our side, we feel this is something which is not done at the design level at all. This is always done only after the content is completely developed, where there is a less scope for improving the content. So it's very important that we need to think that we should have the evaluation strategies in place even before we start developing the content. And while we are designing itself, we need to think about, depending on the content, context, and the and all other parameters, we should also decide what is the suitable media you will be developing. Most of the times after we start developing, we will keep thinking like, okay, this is not working out with this video, let me go to audio. This is not working out with audio, let me go to video. So, but it should be done at the design level itself so that we don't lose our time in spending it to review again. many of the content which is uploaded in Diksha by state, sometimes when we see the content, the media which has been selected, the mode in which it has been done is not really relevant to the content which is actually covered in that topic. Some content is, for example, there is a story which you wanted to just help for listening. The content is for listening skills. But in that listening skill video, it is for a language teaching lesson. There is a listening skill video. But in that video, there are more of visuals. What is the learning outcome they are trying to achieve is to improve the listening skill using this video. But in the video, the features added are more of visuals. When we show this to a child, the child gets distracted by the visuals and not getting really towards listening. So this kind of things can be avoided only if we put a lot of thought while we design itself about what media we are choosing and whether it is a suitable media for it. We, for example, I'm just showing various formats of video. Many times for us, video is just video recorded in the studio. And it is sometimes, most of the time, it is somebody sitting before the camera and keep on presenting. That is how it keeps going. But videos also have a lot of variety of formats which has to be used in each particular time. For every resource which we are going to learn in coming days, we'll also learn what are the various formats available. So this is only an example I'm showing. So many times we call it as I'm going to prepare a documentary. But what really documentary means, you have to have the factual information from which you have taken as a reference, and then you have to create that as an e-content. For example, NCERT has created a series of personalities 10, 15 years back. Last year, we got a RTI, which was asking about that particular video, who has created this, which books were referred, because it is about a national freedom fighter. The content which has been given there was contradicting with some communities. So they wanted, it has become a social issue. So they wanted to know really which are the documents, because it's a documentary that has been prepared. They wanted to know which books were referred for this, from where this fact was used for creating. After 15 years, if NCERT has to give a response for such a question, how NCERT can do that? Only if we have all the documents in place with us. So very important thing is, if you are creating a documentary-based video resource, all the documentation of the references and all the resource material becomes mandatory. So the references also has to be included as a resource in your video itself. So this is how the format makes a difference. For example, I'm going to record a discussion-based video. So when we have discussion-based, it's only two, three people sitting there. They are talking to each other. Whatever they are talking, it's getting recorded. So I need not keep everything as a reference there. But in the discussion, if some teacher is, presenter is talking about this is the statistics. He may say, like, in 2007, 80% of the people were doing this, or 80% of crop production was done by that. It is a discussion between two people, but that is a fact and a number which you are, statistics which you are using in the discussion. So in such videos, at the bottom, there should be a reference link of where that fact has been taken from. It can be popped up when he is talking about, or it can be given as a reference at the end of the video itself. Most of the time, we think that all the references is only for a written document, but which is not really true. We need to consider all this while we are designing. So it's very important that we need to know what are the formats which we are going to develop. According to that, we will start the development process. So I'll just stop my screen for a moment here and would like to know if there is any particular question related to this. Yeah, no idea about Vox Populi. We will be covering that in the next session when we have a separate sessions on development of video. So we will be in detail going into it. In my presentation, I just want to bring the essence, so I have just shown it. Okay, everyone's question is coming on Vox Populi. So let me hold this. Please hold this question with you because we have a separate session on that. We'll surely tell you during that time. Okay. So is there any question very specific to this too? All the things, whatever I show, docudrama, whatever formats is there in every session which is coming up, when we talk about interactives, we will talk about all the formats of interactives. When we talk about video, we will explain you all the formats of the video. So please hold on for that. Any questions related to design itself? Please light on metacognition process again. Okay. Right. So let me share my screen again to take it forward. Right. For example, let us take this example of pH value. Okay. I've created a very simple video as a resource to show that maybe you have used the simulation from FET. And you are just showing that when you take the pH, like a pH paper and you dip and find out it is acidic or it is base. That is what you are using for test for acidic and base. You are taking different resource and you are getting it recorded as a video. What happens when I dip the litmus paper, how color changes? From that you are going to tell at the end, whenever you dip litmus paper in this particular solution or you just touch any object, depending on the pH value, the color changes. Okay. So this is a particular video you are planning to record. Many times what we do, we will just record as it is, where we will explain every step by step, and there will be a conclusion saying that when you when the red litmus paper is dipped in this, if it is this, it will turn to blue litmus paper, blue color. It is like that, we will conclude it. What will happen here is the viewers of that particular video just will be observing you, will not even have anything to think about. Because everything is explained by you, everything is told by you, everything is concluded by you. Instead of that, if you can leave few questions at the end to have a thought process, okay? Like pH value, what question I can say. Right now, the people who prepare the soaps, okay, they are preparing a lot of variety of soaps. So you can leave with the question, because you would have taken soap also as one of the items where you would have checked the pH value, and the soap you would have taken would vary from each soap to soap. 2-3 soaps you have shown, and you have shown the pH value of 3 soaps in your video itself. At the end, you can leave a question with the students. While the producers of soap companies, the soap companies, is it necessary for the soap company to keep the pH value low when they are producing a soap? This could be a very simple question which can be asked at the end of your video, which is not exactly relevant to your, which is given in the textbook. But this question in your video will ask, make the child to think whether it is right or not. It's not just a think, they also need to think about whether they need to do it or not. When they think do it or not, it also brings them thought, is it ethical to do it? Is it just for business they can do it? Because more foam will come only to do this. So these are some of the thoughts which will be left in the child to think a lot and then go forward for the next level. So when we organize our knowledge, if you see, there are 4 levels of knowledge. In that, metacognition is the at the topmost knowledge which we talk about. So fact is something which you will just listen and memorize, right? Fact is something which you need to just memorize. The second level, conceptual, when you go for conceptual, you have to have some facts. You need to understand, then only you will understand that concept. But third is like when you apply, then you will be able to solve issues. So that becomes a procedural knowledge, the third level of knowledge. The fourth level of knowledge, having known some fact, having known this is what is the concept, this is a procedure. Now, what is the decisions to be made? So that is where we think until, that is where the critical thinking and all this 21st century skills also comes in. So it's very important when we create e-content, we should also keep all the four levels of knowledge in mind. So that is one of the things which we need to think about. So let me just move to the next slide where we were talking about this design part. The first part which we discussed till now is the instructional strategy design. As I said, there are two more design parts which we really need to think about. One is the visual design, another is the technical design. So when we just go to the visual design, I have decided to make a H5P content which has 10 multiple choice questions to be given for practice. It's not for assessment, it is for practice. So when you are going to prepare, when you create a content, you will have a first slide. Then you will always have a content like going to the next slide, then will first question will come. Third slide, you will have the second question like that, okay? So when I talk about the use graphical user interface, it talks about how it looks to the child, what all features it will be there in the content. When I create, is there a next button? For the child to understand that I have to go forward to the next slide. If you keep only one slide with only instruction, attempt all the questions without any instruction that you have to click or if it has to move forward, the feature of keeping a next button is part of your graphical user interface. Like for example, I can show example from the website. Let us take any website. Okay, I'm just taking the CIT website. In this particular website, there are few features. This is the graphical interface in this includes some of the features. For example, we have kept this tabs for them to categorize the content which is there in the website. This is one of the features as part of our graphical user interface. For example, in your e-content, if you have 5 topics, okay, in one video, then it cannot go running as part of video. There should be an interface where there is possibility to show that there are 5 content on the slide and we are in the third content. And you can also see here when I want to do here, I have made everything here in this website is clickable. So to show that it is clickable, there is a hand which moves to show that it is clickable. Making it clickable is also a graphical interface feature. Making here a font for, you can see here, minus, plus, and the normal font. So if somebody wants to increase the size to see this one, this is also a graphical user interface feature. So like this, even in our content, we need to think about the interface features. Whether there is a need for some instruction, whether there is a color coding required, whether the button is required for a child to understand that I have to click here. Instead of just writing next, write it as click here to go to the next slide. So these are small, small things which have comes under the graphical user interface, which has to be used in our design part itself. We need to think all about all this in our part itself. And also about the font. Many times when we create our content, we do not bother about the font. We try to put a lot of content into our things in our slides, but font size is not visible for everyone. So what is the font size which is appropriate? there is a technical specification that in any of your resources, this is the font which you have to use. I'm not going to explain everything, but in the guideline which we have shared with you, all these things are detailed explained, that what all the things has to be taken care of, what all the font size you need to do. And also right now we have come up with another guideline for children with special needs. If the children is partially blind, what should be the font size? If the child is able to see completely, what should be the font size? If the child has a kind of a spot blindness, what should be the font size? So for every specification, even font size are defined. So it's very important that we also need to take care of the font which we are using in our in the e-content and the layout we use it. For example, I am showing a presentation slide to you now. So I have made my layout such that there will be a title here to show the title to the participants on which point we are talking, so that they are able to see which point I am talking on. Otherwise, suddenly somebody getting inside will not even understand which point I am talking now. If I only kept these three bullets, they'll not be able to understand what I'm speaking. So the layout is very, very important, that we always understand that there is a flow. So in whole presentation, if you see, I've made it as a layout that the title will be with a purple background and in white text. So when you are going through, coming along with me, you will understand whatever I'm writing here is the heading. Similarly, the layout I have designed is when I'm going to give a video along with the text, then how much I'm going to give a space for video, how much I'll give the space for text. Maybe a visual video. This is some templates which we need to come out and design first itself. So the very simple thing is, as a state, we need to have certain templates designed when we disseminate the work of e-content development. We call team a lot of people for e-content development workshop, and we tell them, okay, you create this video. But when you see that one person would have used only 1/4 of the page for an image and 3/4 for text. Another person would have used 50% of the screen for image and 50% for the text. So that is how it keeps going on. So it is very important that there should be certain layout so that there will be a uniformity. And there, why uniformity? Because we are giving this to children, where children have to understand what is this means. We have to use certain uniform formats so that it doesn't disturb the students' learning also. The third one which we were talking about is the technical design. When we say technical design, it talks about this 6 points. This is one of the point which is really, really not dealt or taken into consideration many times. So many times we create a video, the ratio in which we use create the video. It may play in Diksha, it may not play in Diksha. For example, recently we told in one of the e-content tutorial development workshop, we told every participant, okay, you all start creating the content. And video tutorial with a screenshot and voiceover. So most of them have submitted. We have got 300 videos out of that workshop. But when we started uploading all of that into the Diksha platform, we could see some 8 videos were not playing. We were not able to find out why it is not playing, because Diksha supports MP4. Our videos were in MP4. We also see that the content of the ratio, aspect ratio was as per the standard format. Our video was in the standard format, but still some videos were not playing. But when we wanted to check that, we found that there is a ratio which has to be dealt as the recent resolution is 174, but Diksha supports only up to the resolution point of 172. But the person who was created in the system has set as 174, because of which content was uploaded, it was reviewed, it was completely made live. But after that, the resource, the learners were not able to see the video. So this is why we have to decide that when we create a content, it should be today able to be uploaded in our platform. Tomorrow, it should be able to be uploaded in the another platform also. If that has to be done, there are six parameters. These are the six parameters we need to keep it in our mind. It should be accessible to all learners, not only to the learners. I'm taking the example of Diksha, in which we are right now working out itself, because we are all working towards that. When you upload a content PDF into the Diksha platform, normally, if it is a PDF file, if you can read it in your mobile, you can use a tool and then read the PDF. Right? If a person is visually challenged, they can use other accessible external tools and read the PDF. But when you upload a content into Diksha portal, it converts the PDF into a format which is not possible to read by an external tool. So right now, the accessibility feature is not there, towards which Diksha, we are working to bring this feature into every possible content we are uploading. Similarly, our content itself should have that accessibility. So we have one separate session on how to create e-content for inclusive classroom, where we will be discussing this in detail, so that we will be able to understand all the parameters of accessibility which need to be included in our content. The second one is usability. Today, like many of us have created lots of H5P content and we have completed. But today H5P has started moving many types to proprietary. You can only use those things when it is paid software. You have already uploaded it. But what happens is you cannot modify it, that particular thing, using a free tool. So whenever you are using, because sometimes we don't even mention anywhere what version of the tool has been used to work on that. We don't have a record of it. It's not to mention everything in the e-content, but there should be a document with a state written, this content is developed with this particular software of this version. Because when the version is changing, the feature may get lost. Then our content becomes not possible to use it further. So usability also is a very important thing which we need to think while designing the content. Adaptability, it's like it has to be able to work in multiple platforms. I should not prepare only for Diksha, right? If you prepare a content in, for example, you take an activity which you are creating in Diksha. There is possible that you can create an activity like multiple choice question, fill in the blank question, drag and drop. You can create all this content inside the Diksha platform. But also we need to think about whether that can be prepared outside the platform. When people are not able to use Diksha, they can use also this particular individual resources. That is also something which we need to think about. And scalability. This is one thing. We will be first doing one or two demo content. At that time, we need to think if we wanted to prepare hundreds of content in the similar format, then we need to have a document as a standard operating procedure. So that is one of the things which we need to think of. Many times we develop the sample content in such a way that you cannot scale that content at all. So it is very important while designing, because we look at a state level, it is not an individual resource. We look like whatever we are preparing, it should be able to scale it up. Today we are creating one content, we should be able to create such 100 contents of different content. So scalability is also very, very important to think about. The next thing is about the sustainability. How well we can use this for a longer run. Longer run, I don't mean 15 years or 20 years, minimum of 5 years. Can this content be used for next 5 years? Will that have a problem? So I already spoke about the H5P tool. There is the version part of it. So this is sustainability. When you think about, you need to take care of the versions in mind, because some tools will be frequently changing their versions. But they will not remove any of the available feature, but they will be keep on adding the feature. Some softwares keep on changing the feature. So when we are choosing any software, we should also think about all these parameters, how frequently they change it, how frequently they update it. Some people would have developed a software and 10 years now, there is no improvement. If you take such softwares and create the content out of it, then there won't be scope of improvement later on. So we need to be very careful about the sustainability of the resource which we are developing. And also interoperability. Any content you are creating should be able to be delivered, disseminated in multi-mode and through multiple media. So, and it should be able to work. So for example, whenever you are creating a course, it has to be following the features of SCOM package. Whenever you are creating a e-content, there is specifications of, if you create a video, what all the features you have to follow so that it becomes interoperability. So this is something which we need to keep. So when we will check all this, when you are testing your prototype itself, we need to keep all this in our view so that we can design the content with a complete feature so that it can be taken forward. So if we see the develop procedure, develop is a stage where we need to first of all conceptualize what we are going to develop, how we are going to produce it, how we are going to validate it, and how we are going to plan the delivery. So these are the four steps which we are really going to learn from next session onwards till the last day of the session. I've covered only up to the third stage. Third, fourth, and fifth stage, we will be continuously doing it in different sessions. So from the next session, we will start understanding about how to conceptualize and what is the process involved in the production of any content. So I stop here my presentation, and if there is any questions, I'll take it up. Otherwise, we will be moving on to the next part. Do anybody have questions? If you can raise your hands also, we can take up your questions. There's no questions. Should I assume that everything is very clear to everyone? I have more questions related to what are the different types of videos only. So those things we will be giving it further in the coming sessions. There is one question. Could you please explain scalability with an example? So for example, we are, as NCERT, I'll tell our experience itself. There is, like, we created an AR content, augmented reality content. So when we created an augmented reality content, what happened is the prototype, we call it as prototype, the sample which we are first of all creating it. So when we created the AR content, we also have like a lot of things involved. What software is required? How much we are going to invest on the software? Then we also thought how much time it takes to develop one AR content. Then how many resources are required? These are some of the points which we have to, we thought about, because later if we want to develop 500 AR content, do we have sufficient resource? Do we have sufficient technology with us? Do you have the tool with us? All this has to be thought about. Many times as an individual, when you are asked to develop a resource, you use some software and develop some tool resource and give it. Then when we wanted to create same type of resource in multiple numbers, then we are stuck up with the software. For example, morning we were using we have a software as Mentimeter, right? My Mentimeter is a tool which I have started using. Then I keep telling everyone, okay, all of you, please use Mentimeter for your interactive content. But when I go for training, so today I use it, so you maybe wanted to use Mentimeter in your further trainings. So when you go and again conduct, you're scaling up the training. I have conducted one training, you're going to conduct 10 trainings in your state. So I have taught you, I have shown you a tool. So you're taking the tool and going back to your state and start using Mentimeter. After 5 sessions, you will get a notice that you have finished your possible chances. So So what happens is there is a question of scalability of using Mentimeter. So then you come back and say, madam, we could use only in 5 sessions. After that, I can't do it because it's not permitting me to use more than 5 activities. So then I will be explaining it. Okay, there it is not scalable when you are in free account. So the scalability comes in 2 ways. One is you can use it as a teacher because for education, Mentimeter is free. Register yourself and ask for free account as a teacher. You can do it multiple times, right? Otherwise, you cannot use it. Similar way, when we create e-content, we have to think about if I have created one content, can this be created in the same form, 100 contents in our place? The new type of content which we are creating for children who are visual, having hearing impairment is having the content along with sign language as a video where the sign language is created. So when we did the prototype, the analysis is about how much time it takes for creating a sign language and that getting embedded into the video, because there is 2 separate videos. Somebody talking is a video to be created separately. Somebody doing a sign language has to be created separately. Some content has to be made as visuals. Then you have to bring this together. So how much time really it takes if I want to promise that I can create hundreds of content like this? That is where scalability comes in. Interoperability is something which I explained already, so I'm just repeating it. In Diksha, you are going to create a, I think you have experience of creating a content in Diksha. You go inside the Diksha, using the Diksha feature, you are creating a multiple choice activity. Can you bring that activity to your portal? Because right now it works in their platform, but it is not possible to work in another platform because it is built only with the features of that particular platform. The other simple way you can understand interoperability is sometimes we prepare content. We will say this will work only in Google Chrome. This will not work in Internet Explorer. We prepare an e-content which will play only with Windows video. It will not play in other software. That means it is not interoperable. Basically, it should be able to be operated in different systems. That's what we mean by interoperability. Is it necessary to produce every video in HD mode? If it is in HD mode, the size is too large. We will not say this is one main point. We'll not say yes or no here. That is where, what is the context? What is your purpose of developing that video comes in? Because if there is a platform where your content is actually going to be uploaded, it has to have a HD video. For example, if I'm preparing a video for running it as part of Swayam courses, then the video condition is it has to be a HD video. Then I will have to create it as HD video only. But there is no restriction on Diksha that you have to upload only HD video. So if the clarity is good without HD also, we can upload, we can create such video. So it depends on which platform you are looking at, for what purpose you are looking at. Because if you feel it is going to be shared through multiple modes, going to go for multiple levels, then HD mode is compulsory required. So it will not disturb the resolution of the video. If you feel that the content, what happens when the HD mode is there, when the HD mode, the video is created, if you wanted to again cut and repurpose it, it helps us. So these are some of the factors which we need to think about when we wanted to decide anything. Yes, it is too large, but it needs to be compressed in case of uploading it in particular platforms. We have prepared HD videos, which could be compressed to a sizable, ones which can be even shared in WhatsApp. So that is possible. Technology is giving a lot of possibilities, so we can use that purpose. How is adaptability different from interoperability? Because explanation of adaptability seems similar with interoperability. Okay. So this is like a very common question. For example, what example I can give? For example, you are, I'll just give two things from the Diksha perspective itself. I am uploading a PDF in Diksha, okay, which I can just download it. I can adapt this particular tool, this PDF. The PDF has been uploaded in Diksha. I'm just downloading the Diksha, from Diksha, I'm downloading the PDF. It is still possible to have the features of the PDF in that, which gets adapted to the feature where a person with visual challenge can read the content using any external tool. Because the content is there, it can be adapted with various features. It can be used. Interoperability is more of technical feature. Adaptability is more of what I can say. It's a conceptual and as well as the visual feature. Interoperability is more of the technical feature, which plays a role of specifications. It will work in this tool because it is in this particular format. Adaptability is not very specific to the format. It is more of the conceptual part of the content. Interoperability is more specific to the technical specifications of the content. We will be sharing one small content. Though I'm explaining, it may be a little difficult for you to understand immediately for some of them. But we will be sharing a resource with you today with a specific example taken across all this so that it helps you to go through and understand. With one example, you can understand all these things. So it's an extra reading material which we have added to the portal, so which you will be able to see that when the course is open for you. Okay. So I think we are through with these questions. And if you have still questions, we can still keep continuing the discussion. So I request everyone to come on your video mode before we close. Can I see everyone through your video, please? Some of you are still missing. Thank you so much. We will stop here and we will be taking next 10 minutes for a break. We'll come back around 3:55 so that we will have a session, the next session in place. Only today we have planned all the theory sessions for 4 sessions, but from tomorrow onwards, we'll have only one demonstration session and followed up by one session which will be hands-on, so that you should not be forced to sit continuously in a session to keep listening. It's very, very difficult, we understand. So there won't be such situations from tomorrow. Okay, the video is actually not allowed for showing. Right. It's okay, like we will enable it by the time you come back from your break, because we don't want to take the break time now. Please, let's move for the break and we will start again by 3:55. Thank you so much.